Very interesting, and it kind of brings me to just another quick question, because you mentioned daikon, and that's something that I've seen in several studies where there seems to be some particularly stable form of myrosinase in daikon. Is that true?
Yeah, so there's
You
some
know where I'm going with this. To add, can you eat daikon or add is it found in mustard powder? Is that?
It is. It
Okay,
is.
can you
So,
sprinkle
okay.
mustard powder on your broccoli and increase the bioavailability? That's what I'm
I
getting at.
think so. And so I think you're trying to draw me out on the issue of myrosinase and where it is and how it is and what the complications are. So myrosinase is a simple enzyme. It's a protein. It turns out that there are companion proteins that have slightly different activities or that modify the products of myrosinase. To make a complicated story even more complicated, the glucosinolate gets converted by myrosinase, not directly to an isothiocyanate, but to an unstable intermediate that then rearranges and forms the isothiocyanate. So there's an opportunity for other enzymes to come in and sort of redirect the pathway. And one of those enzymes is actually present in broccoli, and at normal physiologic gut pH and temperature and without an excess of iron ions and so on and so forth, there's not a lot of diversion from isothiocyanate to these other compounds. But most of the other compounds are not necessarily bad for you, but they don't have the same phase two enzyme inducing activity. So you're essentially wasting or losing some of the
Are we
precursor.
talking about sulforaphane
Sulforaphane
Okay, so
nitriles.
they're not bad. They're just not.
They're not
Okay.
effective. Right,
Because
right.
that was another question I had.
Well, there are some other compounds called indoles that we can talk about in a minute, and they're
Okay.
present in the broccoli heads. They're not present to any large degree in broccoli sprouts. So indoles from broccoli form, we're going all over the
We're
map
going
here,
all
but I'll
over.
come back. I'll come
Okay.
back. So indoles from broccoli form something called indole 3 carbonyl or I3C, which
Yes.
is omnipresent in health food stores and on health or in supplement sites, or DIM, DIM, diindolylmethane. These compounds have gotten a mixed, sort of a mixed review from a health perspective because it's been shown that they can polymerize or form dimers or tetramers that actually resemble dioxin, the potent toxin. And so in animal studies, now I haven't updated my brain on this for a number of years, but when I last did about 4 or 5 years ago, there were an equivalent number of animal studies showing a cancer preventive effect of indole carbonyl, I3C, to those which showed that it actually promoted cancer. And some of these were even in the same animal model. And what it turned out was that the preventive effect depended on whether you gave I3C before or after you gave a carcinogen. So
Right.
as a lab animal, you're in a cage, you eat what you're given, and then the way these experiments are done is a carcinogen is administered usually for, once or for maybe 3 or 4 days, either before giving the protective compound or after giving the protective compound, and then you follow that animal out for, or those animals out for many, many weeks until cancers develop and you count tumors and you determine that there was protection or not. So it depended on when, vis-a-vis the carcinogen, they got the protection. That's great for an animal. Well, it's not so great for the animal, but it's great for an animal experiment. But you and I get our carcinogens continuously, one might imagine, right? Whether it's from sunlight or aflatoxins in our food
Or
or
benzene.
benzene, yeah. So we get our carcinogens continuously, and we do get to choose when we eat our protective compounds, if you want to look at it that way, I suppose, or else we're eating our protective compounds all along if we're eating a protective diet. So we were actually, this is not, I think I'm going to be able to get back to what you originally asked me, but we were quite happy when we determined that in broccoli sprouts, there were essentially no indole glucosinolates. Therefore, there was no indole 3-carbonyl or diindoleal methane that we would have to worry about. We wouldn't have to do this sort of mental arithmetic and think, you know, on balance, is this a good thing or not? Now, the epidemiologic studies still say that eating more broccoli or more cruciferous vegetables is good for you from the perspective of a bunch of different cancers, et cetera, et cetera. So,
across the board.
So I don't think that I3C, indole 3-carbonyl, is bad for you. A lot of women take it for menopausal problems. It's invoked in the estrogen cycle, and I can't remember off the top of my head exactly what the indication is, but I don't think it's bad for you. We don't worry about it with broccoli sprouts because it's just not a factor. So back to we got off track, but you asked about myrosinase. So all of the cruciferous vegetables do have myrosinase. Many of them have these other accessory proteins or additional enzymes that will direct the conversion of glucosinolates, not just to isothiocyanates, but to some other stuff. And interestingly, daikon, or the Japanese radish, doesn't have I'm not sure that I can say it doesn't have all of them, but it doesn't have the main enzymes that these are epithiospecifier proteins, they're called, that do some of this redirection to alternative products. So in fact, if you were to eat cooked broccoli, so just let's get hypothetical now in the kitchen. So if you were to eat cooked broccoli and you were to want to get as much of a sulforaphane benefit as you could from it, you might add grated daikon or ground up daikon seeds even, at very low level, to facilitate the conversion. In other words, add live enzyme to facilitate the conversion, and you wouldn't have the complication of that other enzyme. And this has been published. My colleague Yuxian Zhang, who was one of the people who discovered sulforaphane originally, he was the one who actually pointed this out to us many, many years ago, and it was subsequently published by others in Illinois. But the fact that broccoli has this epithiospecifier protein means that you're not getting complete conversion to sulforaphane if you use the broccoli enzyme. So for reasons that had nothing to do with knowledge of that fact, when we first started making broccoli sprout extracts rich in sulforaphane, I was adding in a very small amount of 7-day-old daikon sprouts to the boiling kettles once they cooled down to catalyze the conversion. And the reason I was doing it is because once we boiled broccoli, we killed the enzyme, the native enzyme, and I wanted to add something that had the biggest bang for its buck of myrosinase. And I had found that that daikon sprouts had a hell of a lot of myrosinase activity. And so it was really just sort of a greedy, well, I was actually doing it because I wanted as little contamination of the taste and the other compounds present in daikon sprouts. So I was able to add 1 or 2% by weight daikon sprouts to the broccoli mix to get complete conversion. And as I say, Yuxian Zhang, who's now at the Roswell Park Cancer Institute, then pointed out to me that, hey, did you know that we found the epithiospecifier protein isn't in daikon sprouts? So anyway, a long story, but
so that's really a useful little hack for people, including myself.
Yeah, but daikon sprouts are pretty harsh tasting. I mean,
just do a little bit, right?
But you can do a little bit. Yeah.
And now what about the mustard seed?
Yeah.
Is that
mustard seed has isothiocyanates? It has glucosinolates rather. Uh-huh. Sinigrin is the name of the glucosinolate it's rich in. It produces a compound called allyl isothiocyanate, and it has myrosinase. And so, yes, you can grind up mustard seed and use that too.
Mustard powder and put it on your broccoli after you.
Yeah, I don't know. I suppose most mustard powder is okay, but it depends on how long it's been stored. I mean, as long as it's got a, as long as it develops a bite when you eat it, okay, it should have active myrosinase. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. I guess the other thing would be taking some of these supplements like glucosinolates and taking it, eating it with your cruciferous may even enhance, because the cruciferous, the raw cruciferous theoretically would have myrosinase. So if you're taking your supplement with the cruciferous, you may also be getting the biggest bang for your buck.
Yeah.
As well.
Yeah. Well, that's what these, this Nutramax, the supplement company, was trying to do, I think, is to develop, you know, to co-deliver myrosinase from a known source, known purity and potency with glucosinolates. But it's a supplement, not a food.
Yeah.